Hello there. We are back at the home of the former African Union Ambassador to the United States, Dr. Arikana Chiombore-Kwor. This time we are here for an in-depth conversation in what some are calling an undemocratic process of nominating an unopposed African Union Commission Chair. Africans are in uproar, demanding that the application process and the deadline be extended.
We need a woman in the African Union Commission. This option of faki is not going to work. I mean, when we have women, things change. Look at what Faki is doing right now. He's basically trying to backpack off of what Madam Zuma started. So, Faki option, it needs to get off the table. It's not going to work.
Madam Ambassador, it's a great pleasure to once again have a conversation with you.
Thank you for having me and welcome home.
Yes, you know, our last conversation went viral, highlighting the interest that people have in what you have to say in regards to the interests of the continent.
Absolutely. It's a moment whose time has come. Mm-hmm. People are very interested, not just African diaspora, not just Africans on the continent, but the world in general.
We're looking at the election that is coming up in February 2021. We know that it will be bringing forth new leadership, which will last 4 years as of February. We also know that next year is a key year, which the implementation of the free trade agreement will begin, a key component of the 2063 agenda. But what is at stake there when we talk about the agreement, the free trade agreement?
What I would like people to understand is that this is a monumental decision that was agreed upon by the African heads of states in 2018.
Establishing the continental free trade area.
African continental free trade area basically says no more shall 55 different little bitty countries go to the world stage to negotiate for trading purposes with the big boys. Africa is going to go to the world stage as one customs union. It's something that our Pan-African fathers had hoped to accomplish when they met back in 1963, when they created the Organization of African Unity, which was a compromise decision. They were not able to accomplish the building of an Africa that spoke with one voice. It took us from 1963 to 2018, to agree at a consensus of a decision that we can all speak with one voice as one Africa, one continent, going towards one destination. It is going to be controlled by the African Union Commission Chair. 3 weeks ago, Chairman Moussa Faki Mahamat, who is the current chairperson of the African Union Commission, President Nana Addo of Ghana handed him the keys to the African Continental Free Trade Area Secretariat. That means now Chairman Moussa Faki Mahamat has the keys to the continent.
If he's nominated
for another 4 years. What saddens me the most is Chairman Moussa Faki Mahamat has actually shown us how incompetent he is, how incapable he is. You take, for example, Washington office. It is the most important mission of all the African Union missions. He's only been here once. But he tried to cancel, and I said, oh, hell to the no, you are not canceling this one. And that's it, he never came back.
What are the specifics of those keys in terms of how much power does the commissioner has in terms of the agreement?
You got to understand the whole purpose of having the African Continental Free Trade Area is to have an Africa that speaks with one voice. We are now going to be talking about how do we feed, house, clothe, move 1.27 billion people. Not how do we feed Nigerians? How do we feed Kenyans? How do we feed people from Botswana? We are saying, what do 1.27 billion people need?
So he'll be able to decide the railroad contracts.
The Cape to Cairo Highway, for example. The approval will go through Moussa Faki. The Cape to Cairo Highway is something that's needed. The shipping lines all around the continent. 90% of the trade, intra-Africa trade, is via maritime. Contracts to do all that on a continental level are going to come through the AFCFTA. And the chairman of the African Union Commission has got to be somebody who understands why this decision is monumental, why it is important to finish the unfinished business of our Pan-African fathers and finish it the right way. We simply cannot afford to give the keys of the African Continental Free Trade Area
to the wrong person, someone who's more likely to sell us off, to sell Africa off. And so that's why whoever is going to be the next chair of the African Union Commission is going to be somebody who's Pan-African, somebody who understands that Africa's wealth is our children's inheritance, that we must defend Africa's wealth by any means necessary.
Let's speak about Mali briefly. The recent overthrow of Ibrahim Boubacar Keita, some citizens said that they had elected him to bring change, specifically in the insurgents, the issue of insurgents that they've had for some time now. We remember a very famous singer in Mali, Salif Keita, accusing friends for arming the jihadists who are killing their children, as he puts it. In our previous conversation also, you said that the young people weren't having it. Do you think that the Mali case is an example of that? And will we begin to see more of that in West Africa, and specifically Francophone Africa?
Let me start by saying I absolutely agree with Salif Keita. And I always speak to this issue to say, until we address Africa's issues from the root, nothing is going to change. If we do not address the issues in Mali from the root, even the new leader is going to suffer the same fate. We're going to keep changing leaders, and they will come and they will go, because the underlying problems, the underlying causes have not been addressed. So until we address the issue of France's influence in Africa, until we address the issue of colonial masters and their continued influence in Africa, their continued control of our economies, nothing is going to change. My fear is, if we do not have the right person at the African Union Commission, that individual is going to sell out. The contracts are going to go to the Chinese. The contracts are going to go to European countries. The contracts are going to go to Middle Eastern countries. The same people who have built generational wealth in their countries, they are now coming to Africa to continue to build generational wealth for the benefit of their children, to the detriment of the children of Africa. We have got to defend that, because when they come this time, it's a complete takeover.
So let's discuss the leadership of the continent, the top position of the continent. Many people, civil society organizations, are voicing concerns about the election process happening for the top position of the continent. I have with me here looking at about four petitions that are happening on the continent, in different parts of the continent. Two things there. We hear that you did submit an application for the top position. Is that correct?
That's
also
correct.
How was the process and experience in submitting that application, and what was your outcome?
Let me start by letting you know that I actually wasn't going to apply. Why? The deputy chairperson of the African Union was going to run for the chairmanship position, and I was going to support him. I don't particularly care about being the chair of the African Union Commission. I just want somebody there that we can work with, somebody who understands the importance of the African Continental Free Trade Area, and that first and foremost, we must defend Africa by any means necessary. We must defend that which belongs to our children. And I felt Deputy Chairperson Kwesi could do that. So I was willing to support him. Unfortunately, the president did not nominate him. Instead, he nominated somebody else
who was president
of Ghana. He nominated somebody else who was actually very qualified. And I would have been quite happy.
Mohamed Chambers.
I was quite comfortable supporting him. He was nominated on the last day for Ghana to submit his name to the ECOWAS region. On a Monday, he was nominated. On Wednesday, he sent a text message to a friend who had congratulated him to say, "You are the nominee from Ghana for West Africa." And he responded, according to the article that was later published, by saying, "Well, the congratulations are short-lived. I have decided to withdraw my nomination after consulting with Chad." Wow. The word on the street is something happened. There were some shenanigans that were played, particularly from Chad. And of course, as you know, the chairman of the African Union is from Chad. So the question is, who in Chad did he consult with? Was it the president of Chad? Was it Moussa Faki Mahamat?
So to your assessment, it wasn't his choice to pull out?
Some, and I'm simply going to speak about the word on the street. The word on the street is he may have been paid and enticed to pull out. But I don't have any proof for that, but that's the word on the street. Now, we are now down to 2 weeks before the deadline for submission of the applications to the AU. We decided I should jump in and see if I can submit my application out of SADC, because at this point it was clear Faki is not being opposed. So I quickly got in touch with my president of Zimbabwe. I put in my, submitted my documents, and a minister was assigned to work with the process of getting me to be nominated by SADC. It's my understanding on two separate occasions, a vote was scheduled. The first one was canceled and rescheduled. And on the second, again, that vote was canceled this time.
So we don't have somebody from the West. We don't have somebody from the North. We don't have somebody from the Central. Now the Southern Africa region isn't sending an application.
They did not vote for me. They did not meet, because they had to meet in order to officially nominate me as a region. So it is that meeting that was canceled.
So you believe that there's also some play there to block your nomination?
It's pretty clear that every effort is being made to keep getting opposition for Faki, because they know, and I'm going to be very serious, honest with you, they could put a monkey to run against Faki and the monkey would win. They know that.
Now, if a positive response comes from these petitions that we are hearing that are coming up from different places on the continent, is it your hope that South Africa, your region, SADC, and specifically President Cyril Ramaphosa, will indeed this time submit your candidacy?
They really don't have a choice. They need, if people apply, they must at least submit the nomination. Blocking the nomination before the vote is just wrong. It's wrong, it is undemocratic. But I also hope that we can get more people. Let's get more candidates. Every position has an average of 8 to 10 people contesting for that position, from deputy chairperson and all the commissioners, except Faki.
And so you did mention about the African heads of state. Do you have a message for them?
I have a simple message to the African heads of states. I would like to remind them of the millions of babies that are going to bed with an empty stomach tonight, of the millions of women who are dying today while giving birth to another child, of the millions of the unemployed youth who are committing murders. This one is so painful, out of desperation and despair. We have an opportunity to do something. This moment is a special moment. It is a time that we might understand that it is a time that we have been waiting for centuries. So allowing Chairman Faki to run unopposed for the Chairman Union, Chairman of the African Union Commission, is a serious betrayal of the children of Africa. I do hope that you are not going to allow that to happen.
Now, Madam Ambassador, you advocate greatly for the diaspora to be involved in the matters of the motherland. What have been their involvement in these African Union elections?
Again, that goes back to show you. Back to the chairman, Chairman Musa Faki Mahamat. There's no interest in the African diaspora. And yet the heads of states are fully aware that in order for us to build the Africa that we want, in order for true integration to take place in Africa, in order for Africa to move forward controlled by Africa, we need the expertise from the diaspora. We have plenty of expertise on the continent, but it's not enough.
So in the 4 years he's been in power, has he done anything right?
None. Not that I know of. Absolutely nothing. I don't even know what his legacy is going to be, which is why it is mind-boggling that they would want to give him 4 more years.
In the recent interview we had, you just actually reminded me, you made an analogy about Queen Yaa Asantewaa of Ghana, who fought the British to preserve and to protect the golden stool, which represented the soul of the people. Come 2021 in February, do you think or do you deeply fear that the African golden stool will be taken, will be stolen if the right leader doesn't come to play?
The African golden stool has already been handed over to the chairman of the African Union Commission. And if he remains the chairman of the African Union Commission, I can tell you very comfortably that the golden stool will be gone.
Thank you very much, Madam Ambassador Arakana Chiomboroku.
Thank you for having me.